Thank you, colleagues. Now, before we move on to the next item of business, and I call Cabinet Secretary Aileen Campbell to open our debate on COVID-19, I thought it would be helpful to clarify what the Parliament will be asked to agree this evening. Today's debate is part of a package of enhanced scrutiny measures that have been agreed by the Bureau to give members an opportunity to scrutinise changes proposed by the Scottish Government before they come into effect. The debate therefore allows Parliament to debate and then express its views on what is proposed. It is not, however, a decision on whether or not to approve regulations. Following the debate, it will be for ministers to decide whether to go ahead and then make the regulations as proposed. The Parliament will then have an opportunity to scrutinise these regulations through the usual procedures for statutory instruments. I hope this clarification is of assistance to members and to our constituents. So the next item of business is a debate on motion 23416 in the name of John Swinney on Coronavirus Scotland's strategic approach. I would invite all members who wish to contribute to press their request to speak buttons, and I call on the Cabinet Secretary Aileen Campbell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Today's debate offers an opportunity for Parliament to debate the outcome of the second review of Scotland's strategic framework on COVID-19. As Parliament knows, a review takes place every week and considers a range of data as well as local knowledge and intelligence on COVID in our different communities. These reviews seek to manage the prevalence of COVID-19 in such a way as to drive infections to the lowest possible level and keep them there, whilst mitigating the other health, social and economic harms that COVID and the restrictions required to protect us from it can cause. The First Minister set out the details of that review on Tuesday, and these measures are difficult, but they are necessary. Alongside that review, the Scottish Government published a statement of reasons explaining each decision and an evidence paper for each local authority. The First Minister also explained that in making our decisions, we are not just looking at the prevalence of the virus in this week or next, but looking forward to what we expect the prevalence of the virus will be in January and February, particularly in terms of the capacity of our NHS to support COVID patients, as well as the usual winter pressures. So before I set out the rationale behind these decisions, I wish to underline how aware we are of the significant consequences of these measures for local businesses and communities and for Scotland as a whole. These decisions are not taken lightly. Nothing about this is easy, but these are necessary steps based on careful consideration of the data and analysis. This week's review found that the picture across Scotland is improving, but that numbers are still high and progress is slowing. So overall, the situation remains fragile, with as yet no sustained evidence that we are changing the course of the pandemic. Our cautious approach reflects the fragility of the situation that we're facing. East Lothian and Mid Lothian have seen consistent positive...
Willie Rennie.
I'm sure she's going to come on soon to the issue about the travel restrictions. But today I've received notification from TUI, the travel agent and company, who are saying they're carrying on with their package holidays to the Canary Islands, even though many, many thousands of people will be unable to get to the airports because of the travel restrictions. Is there any measures or discussions with the Foreign Office to try and resolve this issue?
Cabinet Secretary Aileen Campbell.
Yeah, I know that, and I recognise how difficult this is, and that we would certainly encourage people to make sure that they do discuss with whoever they've bought their package from, but we would certainly make the point that, and we have done for some time, is that people shouldn't be travelling unnecessarily. So people should engage with their travel operators. We do know that there has been decisions taken around some flights and in particular airports as well, including TUI. So it's a point that's well made. It's one that we absolutely recognise. But again, we would stress the case that it is really important that people don't unnecessarily travel, and to make sure that they engage with their operators and whoever has provided them with the case. But again, it's one of these issues that we can continue to engage with Willie Rennie on, and I thank him for raising the issue that he has done. So East Lothian and Mid Lothian have seen consistent positive trends, and the indicators at the time of the review suggested that if progress is maintained, level 2 would now be appropriate. That move down to level 2 will take place on the 24th of November, giving businesses and local authorities time to put in place measures to ensure that they can stay at level 2 or continue towards level 1, rather than experience a rise in cases following the loosening of restrictions. While other areas have shown a stabilising of case numbers, the decisions we took this week are that it is not currently possible for other local authorities to move down a level, but I hope that the decisions on East Lothian and Mid Lothian show that it can happen. So let me now turn to the areas that are moving into level 4, namely Glasgow City, East Renfrewshire, Renfrewshire, East and West Dumbartonshire, North and South Lanarkshire, East and South Ayrshire, West Lothian and Stirling. Two of the indicators that inform the review are projections on hospital and ICU beds, with most of the areas moving up to level 4 tomorrow projected to exceed capacity within the next 6 weeks. Clearly this, coupled with the current slow rate of decline in case numbers, is of concern, which is why the clinical and public health advice was that there was a need to do more to drive the virus down. Of course, another reason for wanting to see faster progress is the upcoming festive season. And I'm sure, like me, people across Scotland want to spend time with friends and loved ones, and we want to do everything that we can to make that happen. But we want to do that and do it in a safe way. Level 4... yeah, absolutely.
Pauline McNeill.
Why it would be fair
for Glasgow, given Parkhead. Sorry, Ms McNeill, for some reason your mic's not on. Pauline McNeill. Ah, there we are.
Apologies, Presiding Officer. Can the Cabinet Secretary explain why she might think that it's fair if you live in Parkhead in Glasgow and you have a holiday book to see your loved ones, you can't obviously travel with the restrictions that we announced today, but if you happen to live in Renfrewshire, you can travel. Do you think that's fair?
Cabinet Secretary.
I take it, it's essential travel that is permitted. There are a list of reasons and exemptions. I'm not sure, I'm assuming that it's the transportation to the airport that is Pauline McNeill mentioning. The point is that this is to try and restrict travel, to try and stop the transmission of the virus. It's only essential travel that is permitted. There is a list of reasons why people can be exempt. If it's a reasonable reason for them wanting to travel, then that is set out within the regulations and has been set out a number of times. It is really tough, it's difficult, and we've accepted that. But again, we're going to continue to make sure, though, that people can, after the 3 weeks... Sorry, forgive me, Presiding Officer, I was trying to answer the... And I've quite a lot of chat going on in the back. We're trying to make sure that we can make the best of this. We know it's difficult, we know it's tough, and it will impact on people. But after the 3 weeks is over, we hope that we can all then emerge into a place and a position where the cases are going down, rates are lower, and that people can enjoy and continue to enjoy each other's company and to meet up with friends and family. But we know it's really difficult and it's really tough, but that's the purpose of trying to make sure, though, that we can keep people safe and make sure that when people can meet up, that they can do so in a safe way. Level 4 protective measures are designed to be in place for a short period to provide a short, sharp response to quickly suppress the virus. The changes to protection levels will come into effect at 6 p.m. this Friday, the 20th November, and will likely remain in place for 3 weeks. Ahead of those 3 weeks coming to an end, we will make clear what level those local authorities will move into, and we are currently engaged in four-nation discussions to see if the prevalence of the virus permits it, what that might be possible over Christmas time. Before moving on to travel, though, I do want to say a quick word about the role of local authorities in this process. While the First Minister has been clear that decisions sit with Scottish Government, it is important that this framework is delivered in partnership with local authorities. Ahead of each review, the Deputy First Minister and myself engage with local authorities to take their views, and officials engage on the actions that local authorities are taking, and we want to thank them for the positive approach that they are taking. Now, turning to travel, a fundamental component of any approach that allocates areas to different levels is limiting migration of the virus from areas of high prevalence. This is a key part of the approach that the WHO advised to prevent the importation of the virus from areas of high to low prevalence. Consequently, limiting non-essential travel is an essential element of that approach. We've already asked people not to travel in and out of local authorities in level 3 or level 4, and that includes not travelling between level or 3 areas. The local authorities now ranging from level 1 to level 4, it is our view that these steps are essential at this time. So for this reason, we're bringing forward regulations to put the rules into law from tomorrow, Friday the 20th November. As with all measures, they will, of course, be kept under review.
Liam Kerr.
Very grateful to the Minister. Just to go back to Willie Rennie's example, I think Willie Rennie's question was about people going out to the Canary Islands on holiday. What if someone's out there already and not due to return until Monday to Glasgow Airport, for example? What do they do then?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, they'll need to come home, and they will need to go home, and they will need to make sure that wherever they've come from hasn't incurred the period of quarantine that means they need to stay at home and stay safe. Again, we'll set all these things out in far more detail, but that is what... essentially, these regulations are about trying to stop the transmission of the virus. So it travels really easily, And it's essential now that, given the prevalence that we've set out, that we put these restrictions in place to stop that going higher and making the difficult winter period even more challenging as we go into the winter months. Now, as I said, the travel restrictions are difficult, but they're necessary. If people travel from one area to another to avoid restrictions on hospitality or non-essential shopping, there is an increased risk that the virus will spread. There are, of course, exemptions for those who have formed extended households, for caring responsibilities and for work where it cannot be done from home as well as for care home or hospital visiting. There are also exemptions for essential shopping and exercise if you need to cross out of your local authority to do so. Children can continue to move between their parents' home if they live apart, and we'll ensure students can return home at the end of term, supported by a testing programme. While these regulations can be enforced by the police in line with all COVID regulations, we want to see the new laws work through high levels of public compliance. And we'll also know that people recognise that when guidance like this becomes law, it underlines its importance. The dramatic increase in the numbers of people wearing face coverings when they were put into law demonstrates that fact. And we're confident that people will recognise the importance of minimising travel as much as possible for everyone's safety, and that they will not see exemptions as loopholes. Presiding Officer, our approach to travel also addresses the risk of import and export of the virus by travel between Scotland and the rest of the UK and Ireland in the particular context of the volume and nature of travel across the common travel area. The regulations will prohibit non-essential travel between Scotland and England, Wales or Northern Ireland, just as our guidance has done, while prevalence in these countries is high. They will also apply to the Republic of Ireland. The same exemptions apply to such travel as to travel to and from Level 3 local authorities in Scotland. And it is worth remembering, in the light of the Labour amendment, that Scotland is not alone in restricting unnecessary travel within or across its borders. The Welsh Government has legislated to ban non-essential travel into or out of Wales, including overseas travel and regulated travel within Wales. Regulations that restrict or ban domestic travel without or a reasonable excuse are currently in force in different forms in England through a requirement to stay at home. Northern Ireland, a requirement to stay overnight at home, and the Republic of Ireland, a stay-at-home requirement at present and prohibits an inter-county travel in its Level 3 and 4 restrictions. For international travel more generally, the border quarantine regulations will continue to apply. All international travellers coming to Scotland from outside the common travel area are required to provide contact details, and those from areas presenting at greater risk are required to self-isolate for 14 days on arrival. Where there is a clear risk to public health, for example, in relation to travel from Denmark, we have taken further action to restrict international travel. For Level 3 and 4 residents, the guidance, and from tomorrow the law, is that leaving your local authority areas for a non-essential reason, such as a holiday, is not allowed. That applies to holidays abroad, just as it does to holidays in Scotland or elsewhere in the UK. That should not come as a surprise to anyone. More generally, for Scottish residents, we have strongly advised against all non-essential overseas travel for a number of months now, and have pointed out the risk that people may need to self-isolate on return, given that the status of countries on the quarantine exemption list can shift at very short notice, and that advice remains in place. Now, we know that it's hard, and we want people to help people and businesses to come together now as the winter season is fast approaching, and that's why we have recently announced that we're making an additional £30 million available to local authorities to support businesses over the coming months. And we're also setting aside additional funding worth up to £50 million for newly self-employed people. I also recognise the importance of supporting people to self-isolate and the key role that Test and Protect play in controlling the spread of the virus. And that's why we are happy to accept the amendment from the Green Party and will further develop proposals for additional support to overcome barriers to self-isolation. Unfortunately, though, we cannot, however, accept the amendment proposed by Labour, and have outlined today why these travel regulations are necessary if we are to avoid national measures which nobody wants. The strategic framework's flexibility in enabling different regional approaches allows us to be responsive and to prepare the peaks of demand our hospitals and health services may face, which may not fall evenly across the country. So we need to support and protect our NHS and all the hard-working frontline staff, of whom we have asked so much already and to whom we are so grateful. This is always a busy time for health and care services, and this year it comes with the added challenge of a resurgence in COVID-19 infection rates. And this is why it's imperative to drive down the rate of infection in time for Christmas and in time for deepest winter in January, when our NHS is traditionally tested the most. So these are difficult decisions that the Cabinet took this week, to move 11 local authorities into level 4, but they are intended to suppress the virus to the lowest level possible, not only to increase the possibility of being able to enjoy Christmas with our family and friends, but also to do everything in our power to prevent the NHS from becoming overwhelmed with COVID-19 cases at its most difficult time of the year. So I hope, Presiding Officer, that that set out some of the rationale. Look forward to the contributions that members may wish to make, and also to continuous engagement as we navigate a path through this really challenging time for the country.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Now I call Donald Cameron to be followed by Richard Leonard. Donald Cameron.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'd like to begin by moving the amendment in my name. I want to make the position of these benches very clear at the outset. We accept the general thrust of these new restrictions, regrettable as they are. However, as the Presiding Officer pointed out, this is a debate on the wider approach, the general approach to these restrictions, and not a debate on the actual regulations themselves. And we reserve our position on those regulations, which will come before two parliamentary committees and to the Chamber in the next few weeks, especially as those regulations have only been published in draft a few hours ago, and we and others will need time to reflect upon them. Now, that important proviso is particularly pertinent when it comes to the ban on travel, where we have very serious reservations about both its application and enforcement. Nevertheless, this is a debate about the wider measures and the general approach on restrictions, and we approach the debate in that spirit. Moving on to the substance then, I welcome this opportunity to debate the announcements made on Tuesday. I note that while some welcome progress has been made in beating this virus, it's abundantly clear that there is still a long way to go. The news of potential vaccines in recent days has been extremely encouraging, offering as it does a glimmer of hope in these dark days that there is a way out of this crisis. I note yesterday's comments from the Department for Business, Energy and Industrial Strategy that the UK has secured access to 355 million doses from 7 different vaccine developers, more per head than almost any other country. And we heard earlier today about the Scottish Government's own plans for vaccination delivery. But it also highlights the importance of keeping the virus at bay as best we can to get through the next few months. All of this is very welcome news and shows that whilst there are still challenges ahead, there is increasing light at the end of the tunnel. However, Tuesday's announcements also provided a stark reminder that we are not out of the woods yet, and I acknowledge the deeply distressing news that the death toll from COVID-19 will surpass 5,000 people. While this is a concerning number in and of itself, much more importantly, it represents individual lives lost and the sorrow felt by grieving families and friends of all those who have sadly succumbed to this awful and deadly virus. And as ever, on behalf of these benches, I express our deepest sympathies to those people. We continue also to pay tribute to our excellent frontline health and social care workers who put themselves at risk to save lives. As I've said, we note all of the new measures set out this week under the strategic framework. And as Ruth Davidson said on Tuesday, if the evidence points to an essential calculation of accepting 3 weeks of level 4 restrictions in some local authority areas, in order that the prize might be an easing of restrictions over Christmas and New Year, then regretfully, we will accept that at face value. I will, yes.
Elaine Smith.
Thank you, and I thank the member for taking an intervention. Given that the travel ban criminalising people comes into play tomorrow night at 6 o'clock, perhaps Donald Cameron could tell us what other opportunity this Parliament's going to get to vote against this?
Donald Cameron.
As I've said, the Parliament agreed the process of emergency legislation in spring of this year. Two committees of this Parliament will have the opportunity to interrogate that legislation, and the whole chamber of this Parliament will have an opportunity to vote upon it. We also welcome news of further financial support for businesses affected by these new measures, though the Scottish Chambers of Commerce have said that more support is needed as the current grants available do not scratch the surface. And we have several concerns which we feel have not yet been adequately addressed by the Scottish Government. Indeed, we're worried that some new measures have been brought forward with little to no explanation for those who will either be affected by them or will be required to enforce them. And we recognise the necessity of preventing the spread of the virus between local authority areas with high rates of transmission and those with lower rates. But the news that travel restrictions between local authorities and between Scotland and England are concerning for many, especially those living on or near the border. The Scottish Government announced these new measures on Tuesday, and as has been pointed out, they come into force tomorrow. But there remains a wide degree of uncertainty as to how these will work in practice. People who live and work in communities which are either on or close to local authority boundaries or on the border must have greater clarity on whether they can travel to a neighbouring authority for work, for essential shopping or to see family. They need this clarification urgently. More crucially, the police need to know what powers they will have to enforce these measures and what additional support will be made available to them. We are also concerned about the impact of level 4 restrictions on business, especially those who operate in retail and hospitality. Businesses in these areas are rightly worried about the impact of being closed for a 3-week period, and we share those concerns. The retail industry in particular, in the run-up to Christmas, is understandably anxious. And the First Minister called it short and sharp on Tuesday, but shutting down retail and hospitality businesses during the busiest trading period of the year will be seen as nothing less than cataclysmic. CBI Scotland has described the measures as a body blow for businesses across many parts of Scotland, and the Scottish Licensed Trade Association said that there will be many operators who will now be seriously considering if their businesses have a future at all. That's how serious the situation is. And David Lonsdale from the Scottish Retail Consortium said that the introduction of level 4 restrictions in the 11 local authority areas will flummox retailers who have jumped over every hoop asked of them. We have great sympathy with that view, not least because of the inevitable knock-on effects on jobs. In addition, we have not yet heard of the justification for maintaining a level 4 lockdown for 3 weeks, and the Scottish Government has not shared any evidence as to why that particular length of time is required. And I wonder if they would commit to that 3-week time span as an absolute maximum period and enshrining that end date in law. And it's also worth remembering at this juncture that many of the areas that moved from level 3 to 4 have been living under restrictions for a long time already. Glasgow, East Renfrewshire and Western Bartonshire have had a ban on household mixing since the 1st of September. That is over 2.5 months. And people living in these areas deserve to know why this ban has lasted so long. The SLTA also noticed that despite many pubs, bars and restaurants being closed in 5 local authority areas in October, case numbers have barely improved in those areas. These are all measures that we were told were necessary to reduce transmission, but do not yet appear to have had a significant effect. And for the public and business to have confidence in these measures, the government must publish its full scientific advice, which backs up the need for these measures. It's also clear that insufficient consultation has been carried out with businesses who will be directly affected by these changes. And that's why, in our amendment, we reiterate our calls for the creation of a business advisory council so that business leaders can work with Scottish Government officials on the setting and introduction of new restrictions. And we also, in the same spirit, remain of the view that bringing forward new measures with barely a few days' notice is not fair on already struggling business. That's why we're also calling on the government to create a minimum 1-week adaptation period for businesses between the announcement and introduction of restrictions. These are simple measures and, in our view, entirely reasonable requests, and would go a long way to giving businesses more confidence during this difficult period when many are struggling to keep their heads above water. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, we understand the need to move rapidly to control the spread of the virus. And while we broadly agree with the new measures announced, we also believe that more clarity is needed going forward. On travel restrictions, the public need to know what they can and cannot do, and our police need to know what enforcement actions they can take. On business restrictions, retail and hospitality firms need greater support. And above all, the Scottish Government needs to engage better and produce evidence for its decision-making. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I call Richard Leonard to be followed by Patrick Harvey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Tomorrow marks 8 months to the day since the First Minister told the people of Scotland we were facing the biggest challenge of our lifetimes. Ever since then, the people have made enormous sacrifices for the sake of suppressing the virus and in the hope of a return to better days. But 244 days on, there is evidence of behavioural fatigue. More than that, there is growing frustration because people, including business owners and workers, are struggling to see that their compliance is having an effect. So my first point is that the government needs to be better at showing the evidence of the effect. As I reminded the First Minister in Parliament 2 days ago, If the Cabinet's decision on which tier each local authority area is placed was a judgment, as she tells us it is, and judgment must combine with the hard data, as the First Minister says it must, and I quote her, then the First Minister must explain to the people, like those in North and South Lanarkshire, what the hard data is and what the evidence is to move them up a tier when the transmission rate is going down. And if the First Minister says to the people of Edinburgh, as she did last week, that if the number of cases there keeps going down, they will have restrictions lifted and move from a tier 3 to a tier 2, and the number of cases fall as they have, it is not surprising that many people are questioning why they remain on level 3. Of course, I accept that there are still valid reasons for maintaining or extending restrictions, even if the number of cases is falling. But the government's failure to routinely publish the evidence supporting those decisions is not only obstructing the scrutiny of this Parliament, it is also dangerous. Yes, I'll take an intervention.
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm aware that there's quite a lot routinely publish quite a lot of information, and so it's a genuine question. In amongst all the evidence and data that we publish, the data that's available on Public Health Scotland, specifically what is it that Richard Leonard is wanting us to publish?
Richard Leonard.
I don't just want data, I want proof, and I want compelling evidence that will persuade people, that will persuade people that the measures that you are imposing are having the effect that they are claimed to have. Because this is important for all of us, because the less understanding people have of the rules and restrictions, the less effective these measures will be. So when you have... Yes, I'll take an intervention from Mr. Rumbles.
Mike Rumbles.
I thank Richard Leonard for taking my intervention. I'd like to commend him, because in the 21 years since I was first elected to this Parliament, I have never seen an amendment from another party which so hits the nail on the head about what the Scottish Government should be doing to save more lives and save more livelihoods. I hardly recommend it, and I'm just disappointed that I think what might happen is that party politics might intervene to vote this amendment down when the whole Parliament should be supporting it.
Richard Leonard.
Thank you, and I welcome Mr. Rumble's support, and I agree with him that these arguments go beyond party politics. And let me reflect on what happened earlier this week. When the Cabinet Secretary for External Affairs, a very intelligent man by all accounts, tells an incredulous public and a disbelieving committee of this Parliament that international travel won't be illegal, so you can sail off and fly off, but you can't drive, take a bus, a tram or a train to get to the airport. This is not common sense, it is nonsense, and the government knows it. This morning, no, I will not give way. I've given way twice. This morning, I heard from Bruce Lamond, who runs a travel agency in Kirkcaldy. He is aghast at the new travel law and the ambiguity spread by ministers in the past few days and the confusion and losses it will cause him and his clients. He last received money from travel companies on the 1st of March, but was unable to furlough his staff because he needed them to deal with cancellations. He told me, changing information on travel, safe corridors, no airport testing, quarantine laws, effectively stopping all October travel. This basically lost us any income we may have had this year from February. So my next call to the Scottish Government is this. If these health measures are proportionate, will the government introduce proportionate economic measures to protect jobs, businesses and public services? Last week I made a call, supported by this Parliament, by a slightly larger majority than I anticipated, for additional support for businesses and workers in hospitality and tourism businesses especially. So that is the will of Parliament. And I welcome Tuesday's announcement of some additional support, but I fear that the level of this additional support will not be extensive enough. And I fear that this will not stop people being kept awake at night with worry and anxiety about losing their job, their business, how they are going to pay the bills. We must also remember this. The impact of Tier 4 restrictions will not be felt equally. That those hit hardest since March will be hit harder still this time round as well. So let me be clear about this. It isn't a case of the poorer you are, the more wayward or feckless you are. It is that you are more likely to be living in overcrowded housing. You are more likely to be going to your place of work rather than working from home. You are more likely to be taking public transport to do it. And you are more likely to be doing this because you have to put food on the table. We know as well there is a higher rate of cases amongst black and minority ethnic communities for many of the same reasons. The SAGE committee in September said we need to understand the unequal impact of decisions around the pandemic. So we are asking the Scottish Government to carry out equality impact assessments of the decisions it takes and to publish those assessments as well. I also want to conclude by putting on record once again that the need for these new restrictions we are debating today is a direct consequence of the SNP government's failure to implement an effective test and protect system. This government travel ban looks like a poorly conceived and ill-considered piece of legislation rather than the evidence-based intervention we need. It risks uneven application and, as a result, uneven treatment across Scotland. And the risk is this uncertainty will eat away at the trust of the public. It risks criminalising people who are understandably confused by a complex, ever-changing system of levels and a constant chopping and changing of COVID-19 rules. So my final point is this. We should be pursuing alternatives to criminality because in the end, the people should not be criminalised for the failings of government. I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you. And I call Patrick Harvey to be followed by Willie Rennie. Patrick Harvey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Well, I already thought I was likely to vote against the Labour amendment, and I'm more convinced of that now after hearing that speech. I think it's very clear that the large majority of people inside this Parliament, and I think the large majority of people outside this Parliament, deeply regret but recognise the necessity for the restrictions that are being brought in. We need those restrictions to reduce social interactions, and that is of huge importance in its own right. But a period of tighter restrictions is of most use if it is used to improve the wider public health response. And yes, the test, trace, isolate support system does need to continue to be improved, as the Green Amendment makes clear. We've long made the case for wider public mass public testing programmes and for the emphasis on person-to-person contact tracing systems, with proximity apps seen as additional to that. But to prevent future infections, people tested or contact traced need to be supported to self-isolate. We have a reported low level of compliance on self-isolation, and it's clear that much more work is needed in this area. A one-off £500 grant available on a means-tested basis will no doubt help some people. But there will be many others concerned not just at the immediate financial cost, but the risk of losing their job and income for the long term. And the barriers are not all financial either. Inadequate or insecure housing, care responsibilities, emotional well-being and practical help are also among the factors. The Lancet has shown evidence suggesting that people being asked to quarantine in institutional settings is more effective than asking them to do that at home. And in New Zealand, people who have to self-isolate and their families can, if they wish, move into an isolation facility where they'll be provided with 3 meals a day, snacks, Wi-Fi, laundry services, toiletries, and a dedicated healthcare team if they need it, all free of charge. We do need a comprehensive package of support from the Scottish Government. In New Zealand, those people also have COVID-related employment rights, and the UK government must act to make this available, including job protection for people on precarious contracts and a more realistic level of statutory sick pay, including making that available for self-employed people. These are the purposes for the Green Amendment, and I move that amendment in my name. I want to say something about the other amendments as well. Both of them have serious concerns to raise, and issues that I think are very well worthy airing. The Conservative amendment, I can agree with much in it in relation to the publication of scientific evidence. We've called for this as well as for the publication of expert advice and clarification on the role of enforcement. I think most people would expect enforcement to be done with flexibility and that we aim for encouraging compliance first and foremost. But the... yes, indeed.
Liam Smith.
I thank Patrick Harvey for taking an intervention, and Labour would support much of what he has already said and agree with it. But would he not understand that the minute you make something criminal with criminal sanctions, then that is the problem, that you make people into criminals? And actually, these travel ban regulations are so non-understandable that people may become criminals without even knowing they're doing it.
Patrick Harvey.
I don't expect that to happen, and I don't agree that making this law itself criminalises people. It's how the law is applied that's important, and I think we all want that done with common sense. Still on the Conservative amendment, the Business Advisory Council, we've questioned what the intention is on this before, because it does seem to me that their desire in this Business Advisory Council is not for a group which will advise on how best to implement public health measures, but rather for a group which will lobby against them. And also on that amendment, given that we're now in a weekly cycle of reporting, of reviewing the levels, it doesn't make sense to me to say that they can't be changed without a week's notice. That wasn't in the framework that Parliament approved, and I think it would be wrong to bolt it on now. As for the Labour amendment, I very much welcome the call for a mass testing programme. Greens have been arguing for this for months, and improvements to the test and protect system, absolutely. We need to recognise the need to improve all elements of test, trace, isolate and support. But I can't agree to the idea that we make approval of the measures today conditional on other action happening after those measures have been put in place. We can't retrospectively remove the new restrictions if subsequent actions are not put in place by some unspecified future date. I think our decision today needs to be clear and unambiguous. And I'm also not at all convinced that we should oppose the travel regulations. Presiding Officer, looking ahead, people do need clarity. And I want to mention one particular case of a constituent who told me, I got told we are essential workers, this constituent wrote. I work for a dairy and I know that the company is essential, but I'm a door-to-door canvasser. I canvass for new customers. I don't think I am as essential as the rest of the business. I don't know why we'd be allowed to go round doors asking people to have their milk delivered and going to different areas if I can't see my family. Some people are even being sent to work in England. Surely, with people like this in an area which is about to move into level four, this kind of door-to-door canvassing, door-to-door marketing work cannot be seen as essential work. And with the extension of the furlough available, surely employers in that kind of situation need to have clarity to say they should not be asking people to do things which we as political parties, I think, have all asked people to stop doing, of going door-to-door up and down tenement stairs for a non-essential activity. Presiding Officer, I know that I've come to the end of the time, but we are all hopeful that there's light at the end of the tunnel drawing nearer, but we may well have months longer to endure some restrictions, as well as social and economic hardship, and the need for government at every level to focus on how we can support people through the continued challenges will not end. More likely, that need will only increase over the coming weeks and months, and I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you very much, Mr. Harvey. And the last of our opening speeches, Willie Rennie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Most of the indicators for the new Level 4 councils have not been breached. In fact, all but one has infection rates in decline. The infection rates and projected rates all fall below the indicators. Only two councils breach the test positivity rate. These indicators were supposed to give people fairness, hope and clarity, that if they did the right thing, measures would be eased. Through their sacrifices, the virus has gone down, but the level of restrictions is going up. And it is going up through the lack of adequate hospital capacity. That capacity is under threat even when the infection rate in the community is lower than was expected in the strategic framework. Now, advances in medicine and care have helped to secure better outcomes for those who catch the virus. So you would expect that to ease the pressure on the NHS. But that is not what is happening. So I'd like an explanation as to why the strategic framework is flawed. It doesn't have the indicators all in alignment with each other. Why has the NHS not built up the capacity to be able to cope? And why the new treatments have not helped to ease the pressure? And I think we need some clarity on these important questions, because there are some big questions about why we are in this state of moving the councils up to level 4 when the rate of infection is going down in most councils. Now, as Liberals, we prefer encouragement rather than the heavy hand of the law. The new travel ban does make us concerned, but we do appreciate the light touch approach of the police on the pandemic laws and the indication that they will adopt the same approach for the travel restrictions. Putting it in law does make it clear about what is expected that people should do. So I am concerned about the message that we would send if we support Labour's amendment today. I may not have proposed a travel ban in law, but rejecting it may indicate that people can travel freely around the country again. It is important to recognise that how we vote in this Parliament sends a message across the country. So we won't vote for Labour's amendment, but we do, not just now, but we do want a clear indication that this will come to an end on the 11th of December. We also need urgent clarity on international travel. I've heard what the Minister said earlier on, but I'd like more detail, perhaps in the summing up, because it is a nonsense to ban travel to the airport but permit travel abroad. Now, this really matters, as people who have long booked holidays, despite the advice that they've got long booked holidays, they were permitted to go, will have no route to secure repayment from the airlines or the holiday companies unless this is changed. They have managed it in England, so why can we not manage it here? From Friday, most people in Scotland will be in lockdown, just like England. Unlike others, I am not going to misuse the words of Dr. Naboro from the World Health Organization. He said the WHO do not advocate lockdowns as the primary means of control of this virus. The only time we believe a lockdown is justified is to buy you time to reorganise, regroup, rebalance your resources, protect your health workers who are exhausted, but by and large, we would rather not do it. But we in Scotland had that time already. That time was in the summer, when we had a respite as a result of the additional sacrifices that people in this country made. But we did not use that time well. The government opposed, and I use that word wisely, they opposed mass asymptomatic testing. The government believed that a negative test would make people relax and ignore the rules. The government therefore felt no need to accelerate the growth of testing capacity and the labs. Now, thankfully, that belief now seems to have been abandoned. It has accepted the value of mass asymptomatic testing, but it is now rushing to catch up. For many weeks, the tracing programme was well below what the government believed, and the spot checks on the quarantine were not matching the target. So the virus outbreaks were not snuffed out before they could spread, and we are now in a second wave. Now, whilst I've had some criticisms today, I have sought to help and support the government throughout this pandemic. A national emergency demands that. I am concerned that these measures outlined this week may not work, however, that the infection rates won't go down sufficiently to ease the pressure on the NHS. We may be shutting down parts of the economy and society that we have little evidence are causing the spread. Test and Protect can't tell us where the spread is coming from. To a certain extent, we are working in the dark. Now, the First Minister has told us that too many people are ignoring the advice and are meeting inside homes. So I have one suggestion that I want the government to consider today. Whether regulated pubs, cafes and restaurants may be a safer place to meet than the unregulated home. If people are going to meet, Let's make it as safe as possible for them to do so. And I want the government to take that away and consider that with their advisers. And I make this suggestion in line with the cautious approach that I have adopted throughout the pandemic. I want people to be safe. 5,000 deaths, one of the highest rates in the world, is a sobering reminder of how important this is. I'm going to support the motion today from the government. I'm not going to support the Labour amendment, but I do hope the government listens carefully to what I have said on behalf of the Liberal Democrats this afternoon. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Rennie. And we're going to move now to the open debate. We don't have a lot of time this afternoon, so I would encourage all members to keep to their 4 minutes. That includes interventions where possible. Gillian Martin, to be followed by Liam Kerr. Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First of all, I want to take the opportunity that having this debate to thank everyone in Aberdeenshire East who, through their sacrifices and adherence to the protective measures the government set out, have ensured that the infection rates are levelling out. We remain in Aberdeenshire this week in Tier 2. I have to be honest, though, I was expecting that we'd be moved up a tier due to some local outbreaks, particularly in the north of my constituency and into Stuart Stevenson's constituency. But I trust the decision, but I cannot relax, and I don't think anyone ever should relax. Because the government's framework for decision-making is based on clinical evidence, expert advice, and a balanced assessment of the risks in consultation with the local authorities that know their areas best. As parliamentarians, we are in a privileged position to be able to interrogate that evidence and regular updates directly, not just from the government, but also from the clinical experts in our health board areas that inform those decisions. And I would like to take this opportunity to correct some misinformation that has been circulating locally in the Grampian Health Board area, which I believe could lead to a potential risk of people thinking that our situation is much better than it actually is, and consequentially putting themselves and their families at risk by dropping their guard. There appeared a couple of weeks ago to be a theory that Grampian Health Board area might have their COVID infection figures increased by accounting for positive tests from people who live out with the area, for example, transient oil and gas workers, patients from other health board areas being treated at the ERI in specialist units. This very question was put to NHS Grampian Board members and clinicians at our regular elected representative meetings a week past Friday by Alexander Burnett, and it was a fair question. But they answered that this was categorically not the case, and only data from patients with postcodes in the Grampian area was used to inform decisions on the tier level in the Grampian area. Now, the Monday after this very clear explanation from NHS Grampian, the same MSP was in the front pages of newspapers floating now confirmed baseless speculation on how our figures were calculated. Now, any suggestion that Aberdeenshire or Aberdeen City should be in a lower tier based on misinformation or speculation could create a false sense of security amongst the public. It could cause harm. It would most probably result in a situation where people are less likely to follow the guidance, and we could end up with spikes that would prompt a Tier 4 firebreak situation where most businesses would have to close and people are further isolated. To state the obvious, more people could become ill. And no one wants any of that. Now, here's the thing. What we say as politicians really matters. And I want to commend the tone of Donald Cameron's speech in that regard today. People look to us for information, clarity, and guidance. Now, Richard Leonard made that point today when he asked the First Minister what she was doing to make sure that people understand the restrictions that come with their area's tier allocation and the new travel restrictions. But that's not just the First Minister's job. That's all of our jobs. We've got a duty to share the government guidance. We've got a duty to scrutinise and challenge the methodology, sure. But once that guidance is out there, we have to use our platforms to make sure our constituents know about it. Now, this morning, I found that a close relative of mine has tested positive for COVID. And we're now all getting to the point where we know someone who has, at the very least, become very ill due to COVID. Thankfully, with each day that passes, every one of the four governments in the UK gets better and better informed by clinical information and experience. We are lucky that every single one of those government leaders trusts the science and uses it to make their decisions. The Scotland Strategic Framework is Scotland's route map out of this. It is based on science, not political motives. We all need to get behind it and get us safely out of this terrible situation.
Thank you. And I call on Liam Kerr to be followed by Tom Arthur. Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'll focus my remarks on the Donald Cameron Amendment, and specifically its call for the Scottish Government to provide immediate clarification with respect to new travel restrictions and to detail what powers the police will have to enforce these restrictions. Because from 6 o'clock tomorrow, existing guidance on moving in or out of Tier 3 and Tier 4 areas will become law under regulations published a mere 4 hours ago. Breach will be a criminal act subject to a fixed penalty notice of £60, reduced to £30 if paid promptly. Presumably, having issued this fine, the police will tell the miscreant to go home. But what happens if they refuse? Well, perhaps the answer lies in that subsequent breaches would see the fines double, up to a maximum of £960. And in serious cases, whatever they are, the criminal could be taken to our massively backlogged courts. But of course, they may not be fined, because if they can tell the officer they have a reasonable excuse for entering or remaining in an area, they may continue about their business. There are over 27 listed reasonable excuses in level 3, and over 25 listed reasonable excuses in level 4. And these, as we heard at First Minister's questions today, are non-exhaustive. So one can just imagine the anxiety generated for people who are unsure of whether their reason for travel is essential. I think it will create more distress for people at a time which is already difficult for people's mental health, as an OMA colleague, Annie Wells, will explore later. Because where all this ends up is that when someone is stopped by police, having perhaps crossed a boundary, they offer their reasonable excuse, and presumably police then decide if it constitutes a listed reasonable excuse, and if not, whether it is nevertheless an acceptable excuse, and if not, whether that person ultimately will be criminalised. Yet, before even getting to that point, how many people, especially those, as Donald Cameron said earlier, who live and work in communities either on or close to a local authority boundary, actually know where those council boundaries are? Under these regulations, the crossing of the council boundary could constitute a criminal act. So people have to know precisely how not to commit the infraction. And I hope the Minister will address in closing whether the Scottish Government has done or intends urgently to do any work to inform people where those council boundaries lie. If it's very brief, please.
Cabinet Secretary.
Curious to know whether the member has seen the postcode checker, for instance, which enables people to put their postcode of where they live to then tell them what levels they are having to abide by.
Absolutely, but I think the point being made is it's where people are. This is about travel, Minister. And so you talked, the Minister talked about where people live, but we're talking about where people travel, where they are at any given point. And what of someone who has a family holiday booked flying from Glasgow? Flying from the airport is okay, but travelling to it will be, according to Mike Russell yesterday, illegal. And I think, not on the time I have, I'm afraid. Willie Rennie, I think, made a decent point earlier on. Families are presumably being asked to cancel their family holiday, which perhaps they can't get back on the insurance. And to return to my intervention earlier, what if they're already out in the Canary Islands and flying back on the Monday? What happens when they land? I hope the Minister will pick this up. But if their home is outside the Glasgow area, the Tier 4 area, that is not an exemption in the legislation, but perhaps the Minister will pick that up. And speaking of travel uncertainty, if someone boards a train from Glasgow to Aberdeen this Saturday, are the ScotRail staff expected to interrogate their reasonable excuse and phone the police if the staff member judges that travel doesn't fall within either the listed or the unlisted reasonable excuses? Or has the Scottish Government spoken to British Transport Police and resourced them to be patrolling these trains, asking passengers their business? As for Police Scotland, currently, I think we'd all agree, admirably successfully walking the difficult line between enforcement and community policing. The First Minister said police would only enforce the restriction as a last resort where there was a clear and flagrant breach, begging questions around how the police are to identify a clear and flagrant breach and whether the government will issue any guidance to Police Scotland in this regard. My point in conclusion, Presiding Officer, is this. If we are going to give something the force of law, particularly something that imposes such extraordinary restrictions and potentially criminalises the people of Scotland, it must not be done without extreme caution and proper thought. And that is why the Donald Cameron Amendment is right to require immediate clarification on the travel restrictions and detail what enforcement powers the police will have. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Tom Arthur to be followed by Polly McNeill. I would remind members, 4 minutes, please, only. 4 minutes. Mr. Arthur.
Presiding Officer, my Renfrewshire South constituency overlaps parts of both Renfrewshire and East Renfrewshire, which in a little over 24 hours will move into Level 4. In this part of Scotland, it is over 2 months since we were last able to visit friends and family in their homes, and it's been 40 days since significant restrictions on hospitality were introduced. Moving into a period of even greater restrictions is disheartening, to say the least, and I share the deep frustration of my constituents who have worked hard to follow the rules. In particular, I feel for those local businesses that have had such a torrid year. And my office stands ready to continue supporting local businesses accessing the financial support to which they are entitled. Although we face a challenging period ahead, we should remember that although this virus is still claiming too many lives, our collective efforts are helping to save lives. And we also have hope, not a false hope, but a hope built on the bedrock of medical science. With widespread availability of effective vaccines looking increasingly likely in the coming months, we can now envisage an endpoint to the pandemic. We have come so far and given so much to get to this point. And with an end now distantly in sight, we must do all that we can to keep people safe through what will be a difficult winter. And we can also draw strength from our collective resilience. Presiding Officer, across Scotland, local groups, businesses and social enterprises have played a key role in supporting their communities over the course of the pandemic. There are many organisations in Renfrewshire South whose work has had a real positive impact. And with my remaining time, I will share just a few examples. Johnston Coffee Co, in conjunction with Elderly Butchers, have provided over 1,200 free meals for children in Johnston and have also given meals to key workers. Include Me Too Club is a Barhead-based group providing support to over 500 individuals. They have quickly adapted, changed and reacted to the emerging needs of the children, young people, families and communities that they support. They have been working to provide digital inclusion, hot meals to those who are shielding and other vital support services. But a service that was set up to keep people together, they have overcome the barriers of COVID-19 to remain inclusive. Linwood Community Development Trust scaled up their Roots of Linwood operation, going from providing fresh fruit and veg for 40 households to an excess of over 400 households. Over the course of the pandemic, they have distributed thousands of boxes to households throughout Renfrewshire who were unable to access food. The operation has been recognised as a high street hero by STV. The LCDT approach was to provide a community-led response to COVID. They have also provided support to other groups, such as the mental health organisation Kicking On and Youth Interventions. Neilson Development Trust have been providing signposting for individuals and local groups to services, as well as info and guidance. Throughout the pandemic, they have worked with local volunteers and groups to bring people together to provide essential services like shopping, prescription collection, and contact with those feeling alone and isolated. They've helped make and distribute face coverings, grown food and repaired bicycles to help keep people moving safely. There are many others, including Thorn Athletic and the Neilson War Memorial Association, who have worked hard to support communities through the pandemic. And I know that they all stand ready to continue doing so over the next 3 weeks. Presiding Officer, I want to close by thanking all those who have helped support communities across Renfrewshire South over the past 8 months and who will continue to do so. It may not feel like it, but the end is in sight, and together we'll get there.
Thank you, Mr. Arthur. I call Polly McNeill to be followed by Shona Robison. Polly McNeill.
I don't believe that we've had a straightforward outline so far as how Glasgow arrived at level 4 lockdown. COVID-19 is not under control in the central belt of Scotland, even though we were in Tier 3 for several weeks. So I do need to put some faith in the First Minister's answer to me yesterday in her statement that she would aim to get us into Level 2. So there's a lot of pain ahead for Glaswegians, and I know that we'll all play our part in controlling, helping to control the virus. But I still have some concerns about what key information is not readily available to allow us to form a view as to why we didn't turn the corner in the last few months when the previous restrictions were set. There must be clarity in all of these rules, and I don't believe there has been full clarity today. So I'm trying to understand the restrictions on travel abroad. So I think I understand it now, but perhaps I'll get clarifications. It appears the government is saying that it's unlawful for Glaswegians to travel to the airport, unless that's on compassionate grounds. But what I'm not clear about is if you come from a level 0 or level 1 area, can you still travel to Glasgow Airport, which is a level 4? So we need clarity in the government's wording, and the answer to that is yes. Well, if the answer to that is yes, you can maybe understand why Glaswegians are going to be really upset to find out that because of level 4 restrictions, they'll have to unbook their holidays. So the government needs to address this as a matter of urgency, because that means people are going to... Well, Michael Matheson's shaking his head. But of course I will, yeah.
Cabinet Secretary Michael Matheson.
Just to clarify that, if you look at the regulations, for those who live in level 3 or level 4 areas, to leave the local authority area, whether it be in Scotland or to go on an international flight, would be covered by these regulations.
To the front, Mr Matheson.
However,
please.
If you
to the front, Mr Matheson, please. Address the front and to the microphone.
Sorry, apologies, Presiding Officer. However, if you live in a local authority area that is not level 2 or 3, thereby it is 2, 1 or 0, and you have essential overseas travel, then you can still travel to the airport for the purpose of that flight.
Polly McNeill.
Yes, that's what I thought was the case. And I think ministers are going to have to explain. But yes, that's the point, Minister, that Glaswegians are going to be very upset to find out that they won't be able to. And I don't, to be honest with you, I mean, I'm trying to listen so that I understand it. But I don't think you understand how upsetting this is going to be to many travellers. It might be necessary, but the government does need to address this particular issue. I feel really sad for a lot of traders and retail workers who are missing out. I think Donald Cameron mentioned this point. December is a month of which many of those businesses will make up what they've lost. Supermarkets can trade with few restrictions, and there are many online businesses out there are going to be able to capitalise on this. So I do believe that compensation is going to be needed in order to recognise this. Presiding Officer, I know you said you'd be a strict 4 minutes, and I'm not actually down to 4 to 4 seconds. I don't know if I'm going to get any more time.
I'm afraid closing speakers will lose it, that's all.
Okay, well, I'll cut to the chase then. I've missed out a whole bit of my speech, but I'm really concerned about the lack of business support. But again, my other question is for Michael Matheson. You don't seem to have done much progress with the aviation sector in allowing them to test travellers. I'm told that you've been stringing them along for weeks, and now you're not interested in it. And the government doesn't seem to understand the connectivity issues that arise for Scotland and for Glasgow. And I would be happy to take an intervention in my last 8 seconds, because that's what I'm hearing. And that means Glasgow will not recover from this virus unless you're serious about getting aviation back to some kind of level.
Thanks. I just say to members that I'm afraid we're very tight for debate for time. I'm asking all the closing speakers to shave their time. I'm probably going to end up asking the closing opening, the open debate speakers to lose some time as well. So please keep to your time limits. Shona Robinson to be followed by Annie Wells. Shona Robinson.
Well, thank you, Presiding Officer. And I accept and understand the level of frustration we all feel, and we all know that from our caseloads. It's not been easy for anyone, and we still face huge challenges in tackling the virus. And we mustn't lose sight of this. I know that fatigue sets in and we want it all to be over. But of course, everyone has made such a huge effort so far, and we don't want to throw that away. We need to look at the new restrictions in context. Scotland is not alone in what it's doing. The whole world is facing the same difficult choices, and many are making very similar decisions. In Germany, held up as a country whose response has been seen as a model for other countries to replicate, bars and restaurants are closed, unnecessary travel is discouraged, and even with those restrictions, it looks like further tougher measures will be required to tackle the pandemic there. In France, travel between regions is prohibited with the exception of essential journeys. Closer to home, as the First Minister said today, Wales has had similar travel restrictions to Scotland. England is currently in the midst of a second national lockdown. Northern Ireland and Ireland have similar restrictions. The point is that we are not alone in where we are. Looking at the same evidence has brought us to some of the same conclusions. The steps the government is taking are not unique or excessive in terms of comparison. Once again, as the First Minister said today, we want to avoid a national lockdown, and by setting regional levels and ensuring that the virus is not transmitted between regions by unnecessary travel is part of trying to avoid that. Something, of course, we all want. I know that no one wants to see this virus spread to communities that are currently not experiencing the same level of infection as, unfortunately, some are. The new travel restrictions which come into law tomorrow evening are very challenging indeed, but to oppose a measure that so many other countries here and further afield are also adopting does raise the question, on what basis would we take a different approach to travel than taken by those other countries and the rest of the UK? I've not heard anyone here in this debate who is advocating such an approach and opposing these travel restrictions explain why Scotland would take a very different approach to travel. And I think there is a responsibility to lay out on what basis, given the same evidence and given the same restrictions, Scotland would take a different approach to those travel restrictions. Dundee remains in level three, very frustratingly. The first week saw a 29% drop in cases per 100,000, unfortunately followed by an 11% rise the next week. So there is more to be done to turn the curve in a consistent downward trend. I'm very clear that's what has to happen, and I think other areas are very clear as well. There has to be a consistent downward trend. And I know that Dundonians are doing their very best, and I urge them to stick with it so that the efforts and their efforts so the city can move down from level three at the earliest opportunity. It is challenging for everyone, particularly the hospitality sector. I know that from the representations made by local businesses, and they are very affected, and we have to support them as best as we can. I thought Donald Cameron made a very important point. The fact that two parliamentary committees have the opportunity to scrutinise, I sit on one of them, the COVID-19 committee, and we pore over the detail of this. And the Cabinet Secretary, Mike Russell, has been there nearly every week. So the idea that there's not a level of scrutiny to these regulations is just not true. There is a level of scrutiny for those who want to take part in that. And it is important that when we talk about politicking, people recognise when they are politicking. There's no politicking on these benches because it's not a popular thing to do, is it? If we wanted to politic, we would do popular things. These are deeply unpopular measures. I would suggest the politicking is coming from elsewhere, and I urge people to support the government motion tonight.
Thank you. And I call Annie Wells, be followed by Mike Grumbles. Annie Wells.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I really appreciate the opportunity to speak in this afternoon's debate. Tuesday's announcement that many parts of Scotland would be entering level four restrictions was news in which I'm sure no one wanted to hear. I completely support the principle that if infection rates are rising and if the science deems it necessary, tighter measures will unfortunately be required to halt the spread of the virus. The virus has been incredibly stubborn, as it's clear we need a new approach to combating it if we are to slow the spread, minimise pressure on the NHS, and ultimately protect our loved ones. However, we also must take a step back and acknowledge the significant effects level four restrictions will have in Scots, from those who are vulnerable to local business owners living in those 11 local authority areas. And like my Scottish Conservative colleagues, I have serious concerns regarding the state of many businesses within my home city of Glasgow and across the country, particularly whether they have the appropriate support they need from this government to continue trading, therefore to ensure that people have jobs to go to. As we've heard from the Scottish Tourism Alliance, admitting many hotels will be forced to close, to the Scottish Licensees Association warning against the irreparable damage to the hospitality sector. Level 4 restrictions do indeed represent a hammer blow for businesses right across Scotland. That's why I've repeatedly urged the SNP government to harness the unprecedented funding provided by the UK Treasury to support Scottish jobs and livelihoods. Quite frankly, time is quickly running out for many. And that's why I'm asking the Chamber today to back the Scottish Conservatives' amendment, which, as well as calling for immediate clarity over the new travel regulations, urges the SNP government to immediately establish a COVID Business Advisory Council. However, Presiding Officer, I also want to draw attention to another consequence of the introduction of Level 4 restrictions, and that's on people's mental health. As I'm sure many in the Chamber are aware, the Royal College of Psychiatrists in Scotland issued a stark warning recently that we're on the brink of a mental health emergency and we are reaching tipping point. Now, mental health support in Scotland was already in crisis prior to the COVID-19 pandemic, but the pandemic has brought about a perfect storm of negative consequences, which has accelerated the problem tenfold. Indeed, a YouGov poll found that as many as 40% of Scots think the pandemic will lead to adverse mental health consequences in the coming year. For those finding life difficult already, no matter what your age or personal circumstances, Level 4 restrictions will seem like yet another impossible hurdle to climb. I've already spoken in the Chamber previously about my mum who, like many others who have loved ones who are particularly vulnerable to the virus, is finding it incredibly difficult to cope. She completely understands that life shouldn't feel normal as we combat this virus. However, she desperately misses the hustle and bustle of everyday life, talking to friends, neighbours and loved ones on a face-to-face basis. Despite finding existing restrictions difficult, now she's been told that she must restrict her ability to interact with others even further. I urge the government not to forget the importance of protecting mental health as it introduces these new restrictions across Scotland. The last thing we need as a society are the new restrictions creating another pandemic of its own, a long-lasting mental health pandemic. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Ms Wells. And I call on Mike Rumbles to be followed by Richard Lyle.
Presiding Officer, when the First Minister said at the very beginning of this crisis that she had made mistakes but was trying her best to work for the benefit of all, that was very understandable and very commendable. What is not understandable and commendable, though, is that the First Minister has continued to make serious mistakes in tackling this crisis as the months have progressed. As Willie Rennie pointed out, there's been an inexplicable reluctance to follow the World Health Organization's recommendations to test and isolate those with the virus. We've had the Scottish Government's clinical advisers telling us night after night on TV that if you have symptoms, then get a test and self-isolate. What the First Minister consistently refused to do for months is test the vast majority of people who don't have symptoms, who were then ignored and left to spread the virus. This doesn't happen in those countries in the Far East that are successfully tackling this virus. People entering our country are not tested at our airports, but told to quarantine for 2 weeks. Now, the First Minister says these people are contacted by Test and Protect, but I know from personal experience that that is not the case. And research shows that 80% of people do not quarantine properly. The First Minister must know this, but where's the change in policy? Without testing those without symptoms, the First Minister is left with only one option, eloquently outlined by Richard Leonard. Repeated national or local lockdowns, which is not recommended, is not the way to do this according to the World Health Organization. Self-evidently, this strategy has been a complete failure, a failure compounded by other repeated failures. Until recently, a failure to provide the data on infection thresholds, which decisions to lock down local areas are based. When eventually this data was provided, the First Minister ignores it in her decisions to lock down local areas. A failure in that the First Minister continually bypasses Parliament. I really get annoyed with this, relying as she does on regulations, which MSPs can only approve after they've come into force and often after their expiry date. The First Minister could have asked Parliament to approve these regulations coming into force tomorrow, but hasn't done so. Instead, we have a simple, non-binding debate and a non-binding vote, as pointed out by the presiding officer at the beginning of these proceedings. The last major mistake, because I haven't got time to list all the other mistakes that have been made, I'll highlight the First Minister's decision to move away from advising people not to travel, to make it a criminal offence to travel in large parts of the country. Any glance at the draft regulations just shows how ridiculous they are. Anyone with a reasonable excuse can ignore the travel ban. The regulations don't define a travel ban. In fact, they give over dozens, I mean dozens, of non-exhaustive examples of reasonable excuses. So, presiding officer, anyone with a reasonable excuse can ignore this regulation. What is, of course, reasonable to one person may not be reasonable to someone else. This legislation is self-evidently unenforceable by the police. It's unenforceable in any court of law, and any self-respecting lawyer, and there are lots here in the Parliament, would advise a client not to pay a fixed penalty charge, but to have the case totally dismissed out of hand in court. All of this is so tragic. It's tragic. So many people have lost their lives or had their livelihood ruined by wrong decisions being made. I started, presiding officer, by acknowledging the good faith of the First Minister. And I want to make that point. I don't challenge the good faith of the First Minister. But it doesn't absolve her, however, from the continually poor decisions she's made, in good faith, but flawed decisions. What needs to have been done? Quite simply, the Labour Party amendment has hit the nail squarely on the head. I couldn't put it better myself. I will be voting to support Labour's amendment, whatever anybody else does. But if it fails, I consider it my duty to save more lives and livelihoods to vote against the government tonight.
Thank you, Mr. Umbrells. I call Richard Lyles, be followed by Elaine Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, I am angry. I am angry that the place I've worked for as a councillor and an MSP for 45 years of my life, Lanarkshire, is moving into level four tomorrow. I, like others, will be staying and working at home in Lanarkshire from Friday for the next 3 weeks or more. Why is that, I've been asked? Why have the government had to make that choice? It's because we're in a pandemic, which we cannot see, maybe touch, and that can kill. I have to say a minority of residents in Lanarkshire just don't get this. Now's the time to say it. Wake up, we're in a pandemic, get real, start to wear face coverings, start to take reasonable precautions, start to follow the advice that's on our TV screens every day. Start to listen. Stop visiting people who are not in your bubble. This is not a game. It's real life, and it's our life. No, I've only got 4 minutes. And it's the only way we'll get out of this level is by following the rules. When you go out to wear a mask, when you take your kids to school and collect them, wear a mask, don't stand at school gates to watch your kids get into school. That surprises me how many does that. Don't stand next to each other. Yes, we can all let our guard down for a while, but we really can't. This is not rocket science. There's a virus out there that can kill, and sadly it has, and will continue to do so unless we all pull together and do as we're asked to do, follow the rules. We've done it before. Yes, I hear that I don't want to put on a mask brigade. Yes, you're entitled to your civil liberty, but you're also responsible for my health, my daughter's health, my grandchildren's health, my wife's health. This is not about we. This is about we, not you. We also need to pull together. For the last few months, I've watched the politics come in this. It's not time for politics. It's time to work together. Hindsight's a wonderful thing. Every question's been levelled at this government. It's strangely been levelled at every other government in this country and others. I'm angry that the personalities are coming into this pandemic. Remember who we represent, who we should be standing up for, who we should be fighting for, the people who elected us. It's not about we, it's about them. Many of my constituents have lost their jobs, their lives have changed. This time last year, the economy was looking up, various places. Now people are on furlough. Some have not made a penny since last March. And we really need to get it real. Places of worship are open, but only to 20 in a church at a time. I have to ask personally, I find that hard. As people want to find peace, Where do they go but to a church or a religious place? Schools are open. As a grandfather, I welcome that. But I have to ask our young people, keep wearing the mask, follow the guidelines, help us to fight the pandemic. I'm getting emails blaming schools. Well, as far as I'm concerned, every COVID case, there's COVID cases in every walk of life. We need to start to solve this. As far as I'm concerned, yesterday I had a dog groomer who asked me if she could still work. She was frightened she would break the law. It wasn't on the website, but the SPCCA told me she can. This is going to affect everybody's work and living. We have to ensure that we have advice and we make clear advice to people. It'll be hard for many. We have to try to make it easy, whatever the cost. We should not count the cost in monetary value, but what we can do for our constituents and our population through this time. This is hard. We'll get through this. The light's at the end of the tunnel. Two vaccines, which hopefully are showing a high successful rate, will eventually come. And I wish everybody well. Let's take the politics out of this. Let's work together. It's a pandemic.
Thank you very much, Nicole. Eileen Smith to be followed by Bob Dorris.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I let the Chamber know that I've got a registered interest with regard to trade unions? These are significant regulatory changes the government is introducing, and as such, it's right that they should be discussed by Parliament today. However, the Parliament cannot stop the government introducing them because they come into force tomorrow. Presiding Officer, it's becoming increasingly difficult to follow the government reasoning on the steps that are being taken to try and suppress the virus. Along with much of the population, Labour has continually asked for sight of a clear evidence base for these decisions. And when the government started to try and tackle this before the national lockdown, schools were closed as the virus was found to be circulating there. But now we're told by the Deputy First Minister and advisers that the virus is not really a problem in schools and teaching is similar to other jobs in terms of risk. But I see the figures in my own area of COVID in our schools, and that's not what I observe, and absence levels seem high to me. And I'm constantly being asked by constituents, how is it credible to claim that virus levels are low in schools when so many young people are gathering together inside without proper ventilation systems in place? Councils need funds from the government to make schools safer, including for increased cleaning, as noted recently in a report by Unison. Beyond that, there is an issue with measuring the virus in schools without a consistent approach to testing. Now, it's obvious that the infection began to slowly rise when lockdown was eased and schools returned, but rates increased rapidly when the government failed to test students and then allowed large numbers untested, including international students, into halls of residence. The government has been reactive and unprepared for predictable rises in infection rates, and that mistake must not be repeated. Presiding Officer, my constituents have been under severe restrictions for many weeks now, and this is adversely impacting on mental health and wellbeing. But their efforts have resulted in a decrease in the infection rate since the last time we debated this a few weeks ago. And I have no doubt that if the messages are clear, then communities and families will do what needs to be done. However, we were told in October that the measures would be short and sharp. But now, despite adherence to the restrictions having had a positive effect in Lanarkshire, including in our hospitals, we are being put into even more draconian measures by moving to level 4, which the First Minister describes yet again as short and sharp. So it's no surprise that many are now finding it hard to believe the First Minister when she says this will end in 3 weeks' time. Turning to the statutory travel ban, which carries criminal charges, can I remind the Chamber of John Swinney's words on Friday during his media brief? He said, we have got to concentrate on winning public confidence in the measures and that much more progress will be made if we engage people and invite them into the national endeavour rather than apply penalty after penalty. So what has changed since Friday? Now the government is proposing to make people subject to criminal sanctions if they break the travel ban. But there are so many exceptions. For example, according to the First Minister yesterday, you can travel across boundaries to play golf. The First Minister also said yesterday that only people who flagrantly break the rules will be fined. Well, who decides what flagrant means? Is that a judgment call by the First Minister? Usually ignorance of the law is no excuse, but this travel ban is so complex, I don't have time, I'm afraid, and confusing, that it would take a team of lawyers to work it out. Can I remind the Chamber, the lawmakers in here, that the law should not have ambiguity, be applied unevenly, or make criminals of people when other measures, such as better advertising to stop unnecessary travel, could be used. And in addition, despite what the Minister said at the beginning, the First Minister said that the travel ban will not necessarily end in 3 weeks. The travel ban law is not a law that responsible parliamentarians should agree to without proper scrutiny. People should be treated like adults and encouraged to comply, not criminalised. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, Labour wants the government measures to succeed. We have continually said this, but we need a consistent approach that protects lives and livelihoods, supports businesses and safeguards incomes, along with a test, trace and protect system that is fit for purpose and allows us to resume a semblance of normal life and working. And I have to say I'm surprised the First Minister and the Deputy First Minister are not in the chamber to listen to this debate today. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call on Bob Doris, sorry, yes, Bob Doris be followed by Jamie Green. Bob Doris be followed by Jamie Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I speak in support of the Scottish Government motion with absolutely no enthusiasm, because no one wants to place such significant restrictions on the communities we all serve, particularly those that I and my constituents will now face within level four. However, I do accept these restrictions are required given the stubbornly high infection rates, with Christmas just around the corner, and the prospect of the usual major seasonal NHS pressures we can expect in January and February. I am sure we have all had different individuals and groups raise questions with us why various restrictions have been placed upon them across different levels. Now, of course, many of us will be within level four, the most stringent restrictions for the next 21 days, and that's brought into sharp focus the restrictions at that level. And I want to make some comments regarding gyms and fitness centres. I had previously made representations to the Scottish Government for the return of gyms and was pleased to have had a sympathetic hearing when they reopened. Of course, that predates the current five-level system that we're now currently within. However, within the current system, gyms could operate under strict conditions, of course, under level three or lower. In level four, however, that is not possible, and gyms will be closing on Friday. I've had several constituents contact me, both gym users and owners, concerned over the physical and mental impact on the closure of gyms under level four. With darker nights and bad weather, gyms will become an increasingly important outlet for those where training and physical exercise is important not only for their health, but also for their emotional well-being. They believe the risks within gyms are relatively low. However, with all seemingly relatively low risks, scale becomes a major factor, a multiplier effect with more opportunities for the virus to spread. I know gyms will not open at level four over the next few weeks. I accept this. However, should local authorities return to level four at a later date, and I hope they don't, I would ask the Scottish Government to consider an amendment to level four restrictions going forward, perhaps in the new year as winter starts to bite. I absolutely accept that this will be dependent on the impact of COVID-19 and on expert advice. I also accept the easiest way to get them back full-time and permanent is to get Glasgow and other local areas to level three or ideally lower. I want to say a little bit in the time I've got left about the financial impact on those who have lost their jobs and those who have been required to self-isolate. Patrick Harvey made some important points relating to the self-isolation grant. I am convener of the Social Security Committee. We have heard about potential issues with the self-isolation grant, including qualifying criteria and how those who apply unsuccessfully for the self-isolation grant could be supported elsewhere. For instance, just one example, are they signposted automatically for a potential crisis grant through the Scottish Welfare Fund, perhaps not, or not consistently anyway. I'm therefore pleased to see the Green Amendment here this afternoon. Our Social Security Committee is conducting an inquiry into how Social Security can support us through and out of the COVID-19 crisis. If we agree as a committee there are gaps in support, and I'm sure there are many, many gaps in support at all levels of government, I hope we can come together to make the political will to plug some of those gaps as best we can. Presiding Officer, in concluding, by and large, my constituents will abide by these tougher restrictions. They may not like it, but they get it. Saving lives and protecting the NHS comes first, and that is why I will be supporting the Scottish Government motion this afternoon.
Thank you, Mr. Doris. Can I call Jamie Green to be followed by Stuart Stevenson?
Thank you. I too appreciate the chance to debate these latest restrictions, but as observed from the outset, we're not amending or approving them. That will be the job of others. others in whom I have every faith in their ability and commitment to scrutiny. But nevertheless, these measures commence tomorrow. So we are still some way from doing things in the right order, Presiding Officer. And the reason that is important is because every one of us knows that our inboxes are full. They're full of questions, and we have a duty to answer them. And let me start with small local businesses. Businesses who accept their responsibility and their role in a global pandemic, as we all do. But they've been on a roller coaster of opening and closing and ever-changing rules on when they can open and how many customers they can have and what they can serve and when they can serve it. Try explaining to a small cafe why they cannot serve a glass of wine with lunch, but a few miles up the road there is another who can. And all the while they're being told by government there is support available for them, but it's only a few thousand pounds. And for many, the reality is that will not cover overheads for a few days, never mind a few weeks. Just like the pub in Greenock who I spoke to, who told me that trying to access money was like pulling their hair out weeks after they had to close. Or the hotel in Largs, who described themselves as being in a zombie-like state because they're allowed to stay open, but they've got no bookings and they're losing money hand over fist. Or a hotel on Arran who said they had to throw away rotten food and beer because the regulations that we passed gave them too little time to cancel their delivery from the mainland. Where was the island impact assessment on that decision? Which is why we in these benches are asking for a minimum adaptation period of at least 1 week. How can it be that 8 months into this crisis, we cannot even offer local businesses 1 week's notice that we're going to shut them down? That is not good enough, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Chambers of Commerce believes that the support on offer at the moment does not scratch the surface of what small businesses need to survive. The ONS yesterday told us that they think that more than a third of hospitality businesses have little or even no confidence of even surviving the next 3 months. Look, I know there's not an infinite pot of money out there, and I'm not claiming there is. Goodness knows, sensible governments the world over are borrowing money right now like it's going out of fashion. And this virus is nobody's fault, but that does not absolve us from our responsibility to make reasonable, proportionate and enforceable law. And my plea today is a simple one in that respect. Let us try to do that. And on behalf of all those people who seek clarity and they seek help, don't just hear them, help them, Presiding Officer. This debate is too short, in my view, because there's so much more we need to ask. I wanted to ask and debate, why is it that cathedrals in Tier 4 can only have 20 worshippers? And why are people being denied their right to worship? I wanted to ask, why is it that people cannot drive to Edinburgh from Durham, but they can fly there from Doha? I wanted to ask, why is it that you can have a drink with a meal in a pub, which is fine, indoors at 5 p.m. in Tier 2, but not outdoors or indoors at any time in Tier 3? I wanted to ask, on what planet do we think as a parliament that a pub in Scotland which cannot serve alcohol will stay open or even survive? I wanted to ask why children can shout, cry and laugh in our nurseries, but they're not allowed to sing. I want to ask why in Tier 4 you can buy clothes in a supermarket, but not in a clothes shop. Lots of questions, fair and sensible and reasonable ones, Presiding Officer. And the reason we must answer them is because if we want to take the public with us through a winter, a long cold winter of more restrictions, then we need to be able to answer those questions with confidence. And if the government can't or won't, then it's not the opposition's support for their measures that they are at risk of losing. It is the public's.
Thank you. And I call Stuart Stevenson before Neil Findlay.
Presiding Officer, thank you. The pandemic continues to blight our planet, to test our endurance. Weeks have turned into months. But what it has always been, of course, is a public health emergency. Firstly, as someone who is a higher potential vulnerability by reason of age, I'd like to express my personal gratitude to the public and, of course, as a representative of a community like others, with people who are vulnerable for a variety of reasons. And the huge majority of our population recognise it in these terms, and we here in Parliament need to recognise it. We honour and respect the work that people across our communities have done in protecting us from the worst excesses of this pandemic. Now, it is necessary to create legal frameworks for those people who wish to test the boundaries of what is permissible, that minority. But the legal frameworks need to follow the public health action. The great majority of people are doing the sensible things, and you know, we should thank them all. We should do nothing that suggests to them that their commitment and action, or for that matter, inaction, is not valued. It absolutely is. Now, the strategic framework that we have helps us understand what we must and must not do. Now, inevitably, if you're going to produce something that is a concise view of what's happening, that might be something you can present in a single A4 page, it of necessity will not provide all the detail that you might find in a legal document. Practically no person in our community will go and read the legal documents. Now, there is, of course, good news. Vaccines are coming along. We're hearing encouraging outcomes from them. We don't know, of course, how long the post-jab immunity will last. And that's just one of many things that we don't know about this pandemic and about creating immunity in individuals. But each development is moving us a little closer to a point where we may be able to pharmacologically get a grip on this pandemic. But we already know that previous inoculations for viral infections are much more limited in their effect than for bacterial infections. Cholera, you need to get injected every year, for example. But the bottom line is protecting lives is the absolute priority for all legislators and for all people in our communities. Money can't protect our citizens. It's the actions of citizens who limit their contact with other people that's going to make the very real difference. It's not in any sense anything more than that. Now, of course, there's no point protecting the community if we don't make sure there's an economy after the pandemic. So we have to make sure that we do provide the appropriate source support to businesses. I'm very fortunate in my constituency, about 15% of it is in level one, the rest of it is in level two. Others in the central belt have more substantial problems. But even in my area, as Gillian Martin referred to in her speech, we do have some hotspots in food processing factories that are giving us some concern. But I think the incident management teams are doing an absolutely first-class job in working their way around that. Presiding Officer, I thank the government, I thank the population for everything they're doing, and I will be supporting the motion that's before us tonight and the Green Amendment. Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Stevenson. And I call Neil Findlay for a brief contribution.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. For almost 9 months, people across Scotland have cooperated, they've been careful, they've taken advice, they've been tolerant, they've implemented unprecedented measures and have sacrificed their rights, freedoms, relationships, jobs, businesses and much more. Their physical, mental and mental well-being has suffered. It's been brutal, it's been painful, dispiriting and all too often devastating, with friends, relatives, parents and grandparents, 5,000 of them, dead, laid to rest at services with a handful of mourners. And despite all that sacrifice and no idea for the long-term consequences, we now have to accept more restrictions, more anguish and social and emotional trauma. Excuse me. I can only imagine how difficult it is for governments across the world. I don't question their good faith and I never have questioned their effort, but it's our job, essential at a time like this, to hold government to account for decisions and raise questions on behalf of our constituents. So mine are asking why West Lothian is going from level three to level four when the science does not support it, or why Edinburgh is still in level three when the science does not support it. The First Minister said a few weeks ago, the science takes us so far, then decisions are political. My plea is that the government make it clear that non-science-based decisions are indeed political decisions. That would be honest, it would be open, and it would be transparent. Secondly, I've hardly got any time in this. Secondly, I want to object in the strongest possible terms in the way that the emphasis of government strategy sees the cause of virus spread as individual behaviour and not a failure of planning, a failure of governance, and year-on-year cuts to public services that protect us and civilise us. The greatest failure has been the failure to take on board the WHO advice to test, trace and isolate, something I've banged on about from day one. Every case from the outset should have been tested, traced and isolated. That has been a major failure. It's not the doctors and nurses who took the policy decision to discharge older people COVID positive to care homes, or the students who by themselves rushed back to university. They were told to, following pressure and lobbying by University Scotland for financial purposes. It's not the citizens who are responsible for the inadequacy of the test and trace system. And it's not the health and care staff who are responsible for the failure to test them routinely and weekly. Presiding Officer, we were told that Scotland could eradicate COVID by the end of the summer. And the actions that we have seen, the actions in this strategy, is self-evidently not working. And we are back to the situation we are in at the moment. I cannot support a plan that puts the emphasis and blame onto individuals to absolve those in positions of power from the mistakes and bad decisions that they have made. Because I'll tell you what will happen with this legislation that we are about to, well, are we about to agree? I don't know. It will be, the greatest impact will be on the low paid, the young, teenagers being teenagers, the old, the poor, the isolated, the lonely, the weak and the vulnerable, those in care homes, those with addictions, and the people at the coalface of this pandemic. And for those reasons, I cannot support what's been proposed in Parliament.
Thank you. We move now to closing speeches. I've asked all the closing speakers to try and keep their remarks as tight as possible. Alex Cole-Hamilton to be followed by Patrick Harvey.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. As Willie Rennie said, we will support the government tonight and reject the Labour amendment, but do so with some reluctance. Liberal Democrats would not have proposed the legal enforcement of a travel ban, but given the public expectation that one is coming, the need for clarity in these difficult times, and the welcome reassurances from Police Scotland, we will do so. I recognise these are not easy decisions. Our citizens have accepted the hardships and privations of lockdown with grace and with fortitude because they understand what's going on. They get it. But, Presiding Officer, I think that government forgets that sometimes. It's why these benches keep asking that they treat people like grown-ups, because if you offer people reason and science, they will more readily volunteer acceptance. Without such explanations, public health measures begin to feel random, a kind of think of a number politics, and that breeds scepticism as well as frustration. Let's take the allocation of levels, for example. Until today, or until this week, Glasgow and Edinburgh both existed in level 3, but for weeks, our nation's capital had transmission rates and hospital admissions that the government defined as medium and heading to very low, while Glasgow's remained very high, with little optimism of downward progress. People have understandably asked why that is. And it's not just our constituents, businesses too are struggling to keep up with the shifting sands of public health advice as well. Take my constituent, Jeff Crowe. Jeff owns 21cc. It's an events company, a very successful events company that has been utterly decimated by the pandemic. He finally saw a pathway to recovery through outdoor, COVID-secure events and was due to launch with a spectacular fireworks concert in Errol on Bonfire Night, and then the cross-regional travel restrictions came in. That event was done for, and along with it, the resources that Jeff had ploughed into it. Every decision that this government takes has a consequence, and these decisions are really tough. I get that. All we are asking is that ministers get your government to carry us with you, to define the problem and the risks and benefits of each possible direction with more clarity. Treat us, as I say, like grown-ups. Presiding Officer, it's clear that the most contentious aspect of these regulations is the legal force around the travel ban. I have some sympathy with my colleague Mike Grumbles, who I thought spoke very well on this, and with the Labour Party. And I said at the top of my remarks that the rest of our group are only minded to support it because of the reassurance offered by Police Scotland. They have signalled there will be no roadblocks, no specific operation, just common sense policing. And we take them at their word for this, but we are watching. And should things change by act of policy or operational delivery, then we will insist with immediacy that these regulations be brought back to this chamber and repealed. And I conclude by saying this. We will not stop seeking transparency and clarity on behalf of our constituents who deserve to know what the hinge point is for movement down the levels, how they can get there, and most importantly, what this government will do to support them in that endeavour. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I call Patrick Harvey to be followed by Colin Smith.
This is all grim. I'm sick of it. We're all sick of it. But there have been moments in today's debate where I think members with whom I disagree and will be voting differently have made important points that I do agree with. There's a question about tone, though, because there have been moments when the tone of this debate has suggested that members will vote against these the motion tonight because we don't like the regulations. None of us like this. Nobody likes this. There have been moments when the tone suggests that because the level three restrictions weren't fully effective, didn't wave away the problem completely, therefore level four is somehow not required or not justified. And there have been one or two moments, when I think one or two members who should reflect on their tone almost seem to have suggested encouraging people not to comply with the regulations that I believe are necessary in the public health interest. I don't have time, I'm afraid. I don't want to go through a roll call of individual members because I want to try to make this a positive intervention if I can. Donald Cameron, I disagree with Donald Cameron, but I think his tone was right in the way that he said government should publish more information and advice, and I agree with that. He said also he thinks people have a right to know why the restrictions have been necessary. The main point I would disagree with is that I think people do understand why the restrictions have been necessary. And I think people in Scotland do want an emphasis on public health and putting lives first. And also, to be positive for a moment, Richard Leonard at FMQs today quite properly raised the situation of somebody in exceptional circumstances. And I hope that he welcomes the answer that he got. But we all need to recognise that in the normal course of events, booking a foreign holiday at the moment, in most normal circumstances, is not essential travel and does pose a risk. Presiding officer, my amendment is mostly focused on support, and support includes that need for support in self-isolation, but it goes beyond that. There are a great many people working in public services around Scotland who are providing that support. Members may have seen a social media post that went viral a few days ago about a library worker in an area about to go into level four restrictions, desperately trying to support people to access the benefit system, to access other forms of support, and with the restrictions they have to work in within the library, feeling unable to do this, and being pulled up by their manager for just trying to offer that support. I'll write to the minister because I don't have time to go into it in detail, but all of us, local government and the Scottish Government, have a responsibility to try to make sure that support is provided as best that we can. Presiding officer, I desperately want to end on an up note. And today, with many people looking forward to the prospect of a vaccine, I've got more reason than usual, to be proud of my mum, my amazing mother, who's been a volunteer on the Oxford vaccine trial. We're all amazed at the work of the researchers and the scientists who've opened up the glimmer of some hope here, but there are thousands of people around the world who've decided that they're going to put their bodies into the biological front line here. We should pay immense respect to those many people. Because if we as a parliament can show the same selflessness in the way that we do our work to keep our country safe as they have shown, we'll be not doing too badly. Well done.
Thank you very much, Mr. Patrick. Mr. Harvey. Colin Smith to be followed by Maurice Golden.
Thank you, President Officer. Today's debate has been a sobering reminder to us all that this pandemic hasn't gone away. Bold talk in the summer that we're on the cusp of eliminating the virus has been replaced with a realisation that until we have mass testing, more robust contact tracing, better treatments, and until promising vaccine trials become a programme of mass vaccination, COVID-19 and restrictions on our lives will be with us for some time to come. The thoughts of us all should never stray from the 5,135 lives lost in Scotland to this virus, one of the worst death rates in the world. A terrible toll that is likely to grow. But because, Presiding Officer, 8 months into this pandemic, we find ourselves where we did not want to be at the heart of a second coronavirus wave. And the catalogue of events that led us here is there for us all to see. The government's own figures show that over 168,000 people arrived in Scotland between the 22nd of June and the 8th of November who were required to quarantine. But just 12% were followed up by contact tracers, yet the government still rejects a programme of comprehensive testing at airports. The impact of the botched handling of the return to university with that last-minute change in guidance by the government is clear. At the start of September, before universities returned, the average number of confirmed COVID cases was less than 120 a day. 2 months later, it was over 1,000 per day, 10 times higher, breaking through the World Health Organization's 5% positivity threshold for when the virus is no longer under control. At the same time, over a third of test and protect cases were taken more than 72 hours from notifying contact tracers to them then speaking to the person with the positive test and telling their close contacts to self-isolate. That's despite Sage warning that taking beyond 48 to 72 hours has a significant impact on the R number. And, Presiding Officer, crucially, the government have failed to roll out mass testing, with most frontline workers, such as our home carers, still not being routinely tested. So, Presiding Officer, the result is our hospital wards are once again filling up, and much of Scotland will soon return to lockdown, with more businesses being forced to close. Now, no one doubts how difficult making that decision will have been for the government, balancing the challenge of battling a growing pandemic with the fallout there will be from the actions taken to do so. That is why those decisions deserve the maximum scrutiny, especially when they mean such significant changes in the law. Yet, Presiding Officer, we are debating the impact of regulations that have just been published this afternoon. Few will have read them, never mind scrutinised them. And we won't get to do so before they come into effect tomorrow, despite them having such a profound impact on the lives of our constituents. And why is this important? Well, we've been here before. On the 23rd of October, the government published its COVID strategic framework. We debated that framework. The First Minister told Parliament, and I quote, level two is broadly comparable to the restrictions that are currently in place outside the Central Belt. Currently in those areas, hospitality can operate normally outdoors with an early closing time. The First Minister answered questions on that framework, but the next day published regulations which utterly contradicted what the First Minister told Parliament and closed all non-food pubs at level two upwards. The First Minister said one thing to Parliament, but her regulations did another. And, Presiding Officer, our fear is, without adequate scrutiny, we will see a repeat when it comes to travel restrictions. It's eye-opening, I have to say, the SNP speaker after speaker dismissed wanting more scrutiny before something becomes law as politicking. We have a genuine fear that we could be about to criminalise people who are simply working hard to navigate an increasingly complex tier system. Just yesterday, Mike Russell showed he didn't understand what the travel regulations would mean, telling the COVID committee that you can undertake international travel, but you just can't travel to the airport to do so. Even a cursory glance at the regulations we've had time to do shows it's far more complex than that. Tomorrow will mean someone in my South Scotland region who lives in East Ayrshire, which is level four, and travels to a beach 6 miles away in South Ayrshire, which is also level four, for a solitary walk on a Sunday morning, will be breaking the law. Now, Patrick Harvey says it's unlikely those laws will be enforced. So why have them in law in the first place? I've heard the argument from some in the debate today that these regulations are about restricting movement between low and high levels of restrictions. But, Presiding Officer, the regulations are clear. It will restrict travel even between two areas with the same level of restrictions at level three and above. We already have guidance in place on travel, and people are working hard to follow that guidance. The Liberal Democrats said They wouldn't have introduced travel restrictions in law. But if we don't vote for them today, it sends a signal to the public that they shouldn't follow the existing guidance on travel. I don't think Willie Rennie or Alec Cole-Hamilton convinced themselves with that argument. They certainly didn't convince Mike Russell, and I have to say, I have more faith in the public than they do. And more is being asked of those members of the public. The rules and laws they have to follow are becoming more and more complex, more confusion. That should make us at least pause before we criminalise that confusion. Asking for the withdrawal of the regulations on travel so we can properly scrutinise them isn't politicking, presiding officer. It's frankly common sense. I urge Parliament today to vote for that common sense and support Labour's amendment at decision time.
Thank you very much. Can I thank all members for their efforts to curtail their remarks? However, we're looking like we're going to go over time, so could I ask the Minister to move a motion without notice to move decision time back to 6:40?
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. The question is that decision time be moved to 6:40. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Thank you. I call on Maurice Golden to wind up our debate for the Conservative Party. Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In her statement yesterday, the First Minister noted that Scotland's COVID death toll is likely to pass the 5,000 mark this week. It is a stark reminder of why restrictions of any sort are necessary. Annie Wells highlighted the mental health issues being faced by many, and that is why we must ensure we get the restrictions right, that they are understood by the public, and that they can be enforced, and that they will make a difference. By the measure of these criteria, yesterday's announcement of travel restrictions falls short. Not that anyone doubts the need to act. We need to take it in good faith from ministers that the data demands these measures to be put in place. But as we have already heard today from Donovan and Willie Rennie, amongst others, the regulations which have been published less than 24 hours before the travel ban comes into force are already causing confusion, especially when people will have little idea where local authority boundaries actually are. We're not talking about clearly marked international borders here. Council boundaries are often just invisible lines cutting through streets. Add in the large numbers of exceptions and we have a recipe for people to unwittingly break the law whilst making enforcement very difficult. That is unfair on our police officers who have done a tremendous job during this crisis. The least they deserve here is a clear explanation of how they are supposed to enforce this ban. It is a lack of preparation from SNP ministers this week that is also so baffling. The coronavirus strategic framework was set out weeks ago, and the First Minister has openly discussed the need consider Tier 4 restrictions since it was announced. Add to that the lessons that should have been learned from the confusion that was created over cafes and restaurants the last time. So, why are so many basic questions still unanswered? Businesses in the 11 local authority areas going into Tier 4 still have no information on the restart procedure or timing after these restrictions end. That will play havoc with staff rotas, supply chains, and forward planning. More immediately, those businesses go into the busy Christmas period facing closure or restricted trading with no guarantee of when or even if the SNP will provide support. We all appreciate decisions might have to be taken quickly, but these decisions should not be taken in a vacuum. Businesses need more time to adapt, especially as many are already running on fumes, as Liz Cameron from the Scottish Chamber of Commerce warned yesterday. The Scottish Government recognises this in our call for a week's adaptation period between announcing and introducing restrictions, along with establishing a coronavirus business advisory council. Jamie Green said businesses were on a roller coaster ride. And there is also a question of fairness here. Just today, I was contacted by Lisa, who runs a small retail business in Ayr, L'Occasion Wear. She says she has endured a business year from hell and will be forced to close tomorrow because her business is deemed non-essential. yet large retail businesses such as supermarkets will remain open selling non-essential items. Needless job losses at Christmas will occur if the SNP do not provide enough business support. Back in October, the previous discretionary fund was announced over a week before anyone could even apply, let alone receive funds. It is unthinkable that lessons have not been learned from that. And I hope we see an urgent update on when applications will open for the latest discretionary fund announced yesterday. But that fund is only worth £30 million, with £15 million for self-employed support. Every penny of that is welcome, of course, but it is simply not enough. As CBI Scotland warned earlier this week, businesses need a significant increase in support immediately if they are to keep their heads above water. The UK government recently announced another £700 million boost for Scotland, and it is now for the Scottish government to deploy it. If they are saving it for a rainy day, that day is now. It would also allow support to be provided for those the Scottish government have all too often allowed to slip through the cracks. For example, much of the SNP support effort in this crisis has been linked to domestic rates, but it is estimated, according to the Federation of Small Businesses, one in two businesses are run from people's homes, accounting for one in 10 jobs. Just because they do not have a business premise does not mean these restrictions will not impact on their livelihoods. We are all united in wanting to see these restrictions succeed in reducing the spread of the virus. But ministers cannot take the public support for granted. They need to meet them halfway. That means giving sensible warning of changes, stop holding support funds back, and, above all, ensure the information is there so everyone understands what is expected of them. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Mr. Golden. And can I call on the Cabinet Secretary, Michael Matheson, to conclude our debate?
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I thank everyone for their contribution in the course of the debate here this afternoon. And despite some of the differences of opinion which have been shared during the course of this debate, I'm in no doubt, even with some of those differences, we all have a shared objective of seeking to suppress the virus as best we can and to manage our country through the course of this pandemic as best we can. And of course, during the course of any parliamentary debate and the political heat of the chamber, we must not forget the fundamental human impact of this virus, illustrated yet again by the 54 new deaths of people who have tested positive reported just today. And my condolences go to each and every one of the families who have lost a loved one. That's the human impact of this virus and why it's critical that as a government we take forward the appropriate measures in order to seek to try to manage our way through this as effectively as we can. Now, a number of members during the course of this debate have rightly raised the issue of parliamentary scrutiny of such regulations, given the direct impact that they have on an individual's day-to-day life. I fully respect that. As a member of this Parliament since 1999, I very much respect and uphold the right of Parliament to scrutinise government and to hold us to account for the measures which we take forward. That is the role of Parliament in ensuring that the executive is effectively held to account. So I'll give to no one in any suggestion that we as a government are seeking to try and push these matters through without scrutiny in itself. And the reason I say that is because I think Donald Cameron in his contribution and Shona Robinson in her contribution as well recognised that although this is not a normal process, it is not a normal process because we are not in normal times. It is a process that has been created in order to try our very best to manage what are very challenging circumstances which we all face on a day in, day out basis, not just as a constituents, but also in our own personal day-to-day activities. And I recognise those who might say, and I fully accept, that these are regulations that will come into force as of 6 p.m. tomorrow, that some might question the pace at which we are taking forward some of these measures. But for every delay that we take in taking forward the appropriate measures to manage this virus, we increase the risk to people in Scotland and potentially more people dying as a result of the virus as well, which is why it's critical that we make sure that we take forward measures at an appropriate pace in order to make sure that we offer as great a protection as we can. And we shouldn't think that Scotland is isolated in the measures that we are having to take forward. England's had to take forward similar measures, Northern Ireland, Wales, the Republic of Ireland, France have all had to take forward measures to restrict the ability of people to move around the country, impinging on their day-to-day lives in a way that none of us would genuinely, who have come into politics, would ever want to see ourselves having to do. And even countries like Germany, often held up as an example of how we should go about managing this virus, have had to introduce restrictive measures on travel. And Willie Rennie, I think, rightly so in his contribution, acknowledged and recognised the importance of dealing with issues relating to travel that impact directly on controlling the virus. And I also very much welcome the contribution that was made by Donald Cameron, broadly agreeing with the approach that we're taking with the regulations. And I also recognise some of the challenges that there can be around the complexity of these matters. Issues such as local authority boundaries. Not everyone has it imprinted into their brain exactly what their council boundary is. But nevertheless, we have sought to reach out by creating mechanisms that allow people to access that information as easily and as readily as possible in the form of the postcode checker, in order to be able to identify the restrictions in their area at a local level. And of course, we'll always seek to try to do more, to try to help to communicate that and to ensure people have access to the information as best they can. But of course, I recognise this is not perfect, but this is important in order to protect the public in Scotland. I'll give way to Willie Rennie.
Willie Rennie.
I'm sure the Minister will also recognise the point I was making earlier on about those who have booked, whether reluctantly or not, holidays abroad and are now not able to get to the airport, but the holiday's not been cancelled, so they won't get their money back. Is that going to be something that the government's going to look at? How is it going to sort it?
So can I seek to try and address that specific point and a number of points that have been raised by members? Willie Rennie raised the issue around, for example, TUI. TUI have now decided to cancel all flights from Glasgow and Edinburgh until the 10th or the 11th of December, as a result of the fact that the vast majority of individuals who use those flights come from level 3 and level 4 areas. In recognition of that. So I hope the member takes some reassurance from that. But can I also say on the issue of international travel, our approach and our advice around international travel has not changed. It remains the case, as has been the case for months, that we advise against non-essential overseas travel. Of course, some people will have to travel for work purposes. Of course, some people will have to travel on compassionate grounds. We fully recognise that. But that advice has not changed. It is the exact same as it has been for months, as is the case in England, Wales and Northern Ireland. And it remains the case now. And it's important that people listen to that advice and act upon that advice as well. Can I also say I recognise the calls for those who wish to see more evidence. They want to see a greater level of detail around the rationale of these matters. And I am very open, as are all of my colleagues within the Cabinet, in trying to arrive at these decisions, that if there are specific areas that members believe there is a need for further data and information to be provided, tell us what that is, and we'll look to see if it can be provided. But I also have a word of warning. It is important that in calling for more evidence and data, that you become familiar with what is already being provided. We had a call today from Richard Leonard that we should have an equality impact assessment on regulations of this nature. We've just carried out that very impact assessment. It was published this afternoon, along with the regulations. That's the type of thing that it's okay to come into the chamber and call for things, but it's also incumbent on others to be familiar with what is already available and make themselves familiar with it as well. And can I turn to a point that was raised by Pauline McNeill, and that is an issue of airport testing. What I can assure the member of is that this is a piece of work that we are still taking forward with the airports. There is a difference of opinion from the clinicians that the airports have with their own clinicians around how any regime should operate. But we are continuing to work with the UK government and also with Scottish airports in looking at trying to introduce a pilot here in Scotland, if that is possible going forward. Mr. Officer, I'm very conscious of time, but I want to make sure that, just as some others have said in this chamber, there is very much light at the end of the tunnel. We've heard from the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Sport this afternoon on the approach we're taking in planning for the rolling out of a vaccine when it becomes available later this year and into the new year. There is hope. There won't just be one vaccine, it will be more than one vaccine. And I want to take this opportunity to offer my thanks to Patrick Harvey's mother for her selflessness in contributing to the type of clinical trials that will end this pandemic, and it will mean that we no longer have to have these types of regulations into Parliament again, and that people can get back to their normal day-to-day life. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, colleagues. And that concludes our debate on the Coronavirus Scotland Strategic Approach. Point of order, Elaine Smith.
Thank you very much. During his speech, Richard Lyle said that because his area is going into level four, he'll be working at home for the next 3 weeks. So I wonder, Presiding Officer, if you could just clarify the travel law in this regard for members. Are members and their staff...
Let's see the point of order, please.
Are members and their staff allowed to travel here from level three and four areas without breaking the law? And I hear cries of there's been an email, but some of us have been participating in a very important debate, Presiding Officer. So if you could clarify this, it would be extremely helpful. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Smith. Yes, I can clarify that this has been discussed and an email has gone out this afternoon while we've been in this chamber offering support and guidance to all members of staff. The advice is still for all members here that we should work from home where possible. However, this is essential business and members are allowed to come here clearly, and they're also allowed the support of one additional member of staff. But I would advise members to look to the guidance. A point of order, Richard Lyle. Mr. Lyle, I hope it's not going to be a rebuttal rather than...
No, I just want to say that's my personal choice and I'm in it with my constituents. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lyle. Another point of order from Cabinet Secretary Jean Freeman.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I'm grateful to you. I've not had the opportunity to see the transcript of my statement and the subsequent questions, but I may have made a mistake in my answer to Ms. Lennon, at least part of her question, so I'm grateful for the opportunity to clarify that we expect to receive 320,000 doses of the vaccine over the first 2 weeks in December, subject, of course, to all the caveats that I set in the statement. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary, for that clarification. We're going to move now to decision time. The first question this evening is that motion 23361 in the name of Joanne Lamont on improving youth football in Scotland be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Yeah, we are agreed. Our next question is that amendment 23416.2 in the name of Donald Cameron, which seeks to amend motion 23416 in the name of John Swinney on coronavirus, Scotland's strategic approach, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not agreed. We're going to move to a vote, and I'm going to suspend Parliament for a few minutes just to allow members to access the voting app. Parliament is suspended for a few moments. Thank you very much, colleagues. We resume business, and the vote before us is that Amendment 23416.2 in the name of Donald Cameron, which seeks to amend motion in the name of John Swinney on coronavirus Scotland's strategic approach, be agreed, and members may cast their votes now. This is a 1 minute vote. That vote is now closed. If any member believes they have not been able to vote, please let me know through a point of order in the chamber or online. Thank you. The result of the vote on amendment number 23416.2 in the name of Donald Cameron is yes 51, no 71. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. The next question is that amendment 23416.3 in the name of Richard Leonard, which seeks to amend the motion in the name of John Swinney, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not agreed. We'll move to a vote. Members, please cast their votes now. That vote is now closed. Any members who do not believe they were able to register a vote, please let me know through a point of order. Jeremy Balfour, please. No vote recorded, okay. I'll take a point of order from Jeremy Balfour. Jeremy Balfour. Thank you, Mr. Balfour. We can see you now. However, Mr. Balfour, you are on mute. Mr. Balfour, you're on mute, so if you wish to register your vote again, please. Thank you. Mr. Balfour, this is unusual, but I think your mic is not working. Can I ask you to shake your head, either no or yes, to indicate which way you were voting? That is a no, Mr. Balfour. You will be recorded as adding voting no to the motion from the amendment from Richard Leonard. Thank you. The result of the vote on amendment number 23416.3 in the name of Richard Leonard is yes 22, no 99. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. The next question is that amendment 23416.1 in the name of Patrick Harvey, which seeks to amend the motion in the name of John Swinney, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. And the final question is that motion 23416 in the name of John Swinney, as amended, on coronavirus, Scotland's strategic approach be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed. We'll move to a vote. Members may cast their votes now. That vote is closed. Any member who believes they were not able to vote, please let me know through a point of order. Thank you. The result of the vote on motion 23416 in the name of John Swinney, as amended, is yes 99, no 23. There were no abstentions. The motion as amended is therefore agreed. And that concludes decision time. I close this meeting.